country should be overconfident about its financial system. But when we talk about regulation, it is very important to do the tightening job timely. It's important to tighten regulation during good times and try to keep it loose during bad times. So a countercyclical approach when it comes to regulation is important for the financial sector. But most of the time, when the economy is booming, when banks are lending, when consumers are borrowing and spending, when companies are borrowing and investing, it is not easy for the regulators to step in and say that, okay, now we have to tighten things a little bit and create a space for bad times. But for those countries who are able to do this, then it helps them a lot during difficult times. Ladies and gentlemen, when we look at the Islamic financial system, Islamic banking constitutes the backbone, and Islamic banking was introduced more than 40 years ago. And in the last two decades especially, Islamic finance has grown very rapidly across the world. During this period, Islamic financial instruments diversified and Islamic finance spread to now more than 75 countries worldwide. Sukuk issuance surged by an average annual rate of 40% over the past few years, and it is expected to exceed $100 billion this year in 2012. Today, Islamic financial system grew into a $1 trillion industry, and many multinational financial institutions are increasingly becoming involved in the sector. This success was achieved by the industry's strong financial infrastructure, robust institutional framework, and keen participation from both Islamic and non-Islamic institutions. And I'd like to mention Malaysia as a pioneer country in the area of Islamic finance. Especially I remember very well when I visited Malaysia with my prime minister in 2003 and visiting Governor Ziti back then on a Saturday at the Central Bank to listen from her what Malaysia has done successfully in terms of Islamic finance. Acceptance of Islamic finance as an alternative to the conventional financial system has gained significant support in the last decade, and Islamic financial industry has become an integral component of the global financial system. Number of Islamic financial institutions is now over 300 across the world, and they are offering quite a wide range of products. And according to some projections, the total value of global Islamic financial assets is very much likely to reach $1.8 trillion by year 2016. So this means a cumulative growth of 80% from now to 2016 in 4 years. That's what some projections are like when we look at the future. Despite this rapid expansion, the value of global economic assets across all asset classes still remains quite small in comparison to that of conventional counterparts. As of this year, 2012, total Islamic financial assets make up less than 1% of the total global financial assets. So this means that there is still an ample room for growth, and there is a huge potential still coming. However, small and medium-sized enterprises have a huge growth potential, and they are more likely to use Islamic financial products. And also, the rising Muslim population and wealth is also a factor which will propel Islamic finance to the next level. Therefore, empowering cross-border connectivity and creating new opportunities for emerging economies through Islamic finance could be a key aspect of future policies. I would like to highlight one important feature of the Islamic finance. It contributes to the stability of the financial system, as its competitiveness and resilience was proven during the last global financial crisis. Even though Islamic financial institutions were affected by the adverse second round effects of the global crisis, Islamic banks, generally speaking, stood quite strong. Before the crisis, they were not exposed to subprime and toxic assets and maintained their close connection to the real sector. Hence, one could suggest that conventional banking can learn from the alternative systems offered by Islamic finance. Islamic financial system is less skewed toward debt instruments, uses equity for greater risk sharing, and also limits the mismatch of short-term demand deposits with long-term loan contracts. And therefore, Islamic financial instruments can become important pillars while building a new global finance structure and contribute to financial inclusion and financial stability. As I just highlighted briefly, performance and relative stability of Islamic financial institutions stem from the distinctive features of the instruments they offer. As Islamic finance emphasizes asset backing and principle of risk sharing, it ensures a direct link between financial transactions and real sector activities. So, when we talk about Islamic finance, there is no fiction, there is reality going on. And this gives Islamic financial instruments a flexible adjustment mechanism in the case of unanticipated shocks. For the sector to develop further, it needs greater international integration and also efficient reforms. Key challenges are probably lack of diversification, consumer awareness, and financial literacy. Moreover, the reform agenda should also include improving regulatory oversight, rebalancing tax treatment, strengthening insolvency frameworks, promoting standardization, ensuring adequate liquidity, and establishing sound risk management practices. Considering the strong growth potential of the emerging economies, knowledge sharing can play an important role in underpinning initiatives in all these areas. And it's very important for those countries which are just starting or at the early phases of using Islamic financial instruments to learn from the countries which have been doing this for a while, like Malaysia. Because experience is very important. Learning from each other, learning from each other's good experiences and mistakes, and improving it continuously is going to be very, very important. Distinguished guests, in Turkey, we call our banks, which operate on a non-interest basis, participation banks. We derived this terminology back in 2004 because we thought that, especially the risk-sharing aspect of the system is based on participants and being together with all the stakeholders. And Turkish participation banking sector's roots date back to mid-1980s. And since then, the sector has managed to enhance its significance in the Turkish financial system by recording high growth rates. With the new banking law, which we introduced in year 2005, we created a level playing field for participation banks and brought equal opportunities for regular banks and participation banks. Following this new and equal framework, sector's growth has gained a new pace, and participation banks' assets have expanded faster than regular banks' assets. Also, Turkish participation banking sector has grown faster than most of the international counterparts. As of now, in terms of the fund size, participation banks in Turkey holds 5.6% of the share of the total banking sector. Currently, we have 4 participation banks, which have a total number of 762 branches across the country and 14,600 employees. Their total assets since 2005 have grown almost fivefold. With all these figures in hand, I would like to stress that participation banks have become an indispensable and complementary element of Turkish financial system. Another important step, which we have taken actually just yesterday, was that we completed the very first issuance of Turkish Treasury Sukuk. This was an issuance of $1.5 billion. The demand was almost 5 times of what we have actually issued. And we believe that this is going to set a benchmark for other government institutions and also Turkish private sector. Because last year we have already prepared the legal framework and also the taxation regime for Sukuk issues. And there is now an equal footing in terms of the taxation and the legal framework when we look at fixed income instruments, whether it is interest bearing or Sukuk, doesn't matter, equal opportunity, equal tax basis. We believe that there is a good room for growth in this sector, and I believe that it will be definitely utilized by our private sector participants as well. And thus, inshallah, participation banking sector in Turkey will increase its visibility and will increase also its integration to the to many, many countries when we look from this perspective. Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, I would like to just give you also a very brief explanation of what we have done in Turkey over the last 10 years in terms of our reform process and the results that we have got so far. Last 10 years of Turkey was actually very important, both in terms of the political reforms and the economic reforms that we have completed. In terms of the political reforms, what we have done mainly was to enhance our democratic system, so to make sure that our democracy functions better and better, to improve our practices of freedoms, fundamental rights, rule of law. And we have been doing most of these within the process of European Union accession. Turkey is a country in Asia, but Turkey is also a country in Europe. And we have membership and alliances in both Asia and Europe. But the European Union process was important for us, especially for our domestic political reform efforts.